That's Tomlin, head coach, little sign there, showing the respect to the guy in the suit as we're going to be hopping onto the game here, or at least to pick and ban for game one.
And you and I are ready to show some respect to some new interpretations of patch 9.5. Remember, these teams have not played yet on this week's patch. You're joining us for the first time for match number 70. That means we only have 20 after this one, Valdez. Wow. 90 in the regular season. And you would like to know that Silas and Kale are globally banned in Korea. We're unaware of what LEC will be playing on later today. That will patch 9.5, but banned champions could change. And the hotfix for Nico is live. However, Juve popped off on that Nico. Don't think he was the reason they won, but the pick certainly had a lot of validity there. Coming into bans, Notice, Bono, and Punch. Hugely Sin players. Bono's a two-punch champion. It's kind of awkward when we have someone named Punch, but the point I'm trying to get to is he plays Olaf Lee Sin at the highest level, and everything else is a tier below. The Olaf is banned. Damwon look like they're positioning themselves to first pick Lee, and how will I decide? Do we ban Lee, or do we adjust our bans and get two power picks on the red side?
Damwon could also try to ban it out and say, hey, Punch, you play something else, and let's get some other kind of first pick here. As 10 seconds left, they're going to go with the Kalista. Yeah. You see Songyun's Kalista, and you say no. And they're going to say no with the ban.
He's always had an incredibly high win rate on Kalista in solo queue, but also it is a staple of his recent champions and competitive history. So I like the Kalista blue side ban if you don't want to first pick it. Nuclear, where he's going to go on the AD carry pool is interesting. I want to see something new from him because he's not a great Ezreal when we have some real super Ezreals in our lineup and Ezreal priorities going down. And with full information, Damwon say, maybe we'll go Rek'Sai into your Lee Sin if you take it, or take a Jace. Someone has played a lot of Jace in his time. They won't be getting Jace, but they'll be getting the Lee Sin if they want it.
Does open up the question if you'll just grab it, especially with the Olaf band. You would have to think it's a very high possibility here from the side of Hanwha Life. They're going to look down at Aurelia already.
You would assume into top lane it can be flexed, but I imagine this would be against the Jace if that ends up being the top laner. So that's going to be Sowon's choice. He's played it before. Bold to take a skill matchup into Noggery, especially one that favors the Jace. Almost 100% to beat. Noggery's champion, he loves Jace and Ryze. Those are his two picks. In fact, to Damwon Gaming, just take Ryze and work it all out later, because then both of them are Jace and Ryze players.
Saw the win percentage of Aurelia, currently 28%. I imagine a lot of those wins are Tovi. Lucian still is available, as it will be picked up here.
Was played in our first series in top, but I just can't see it from Sowon into Noggery's Jace. That would be bold and then some. Ryze is a really big pick for some teams, but not every team. Again, we already mentioned it, first series for these two teams. On patch 9.5, notice Lissandra available at this point, but not a big pick for Showmaker. I love that some of these picks are big for some players, not for others. And the Lissandra, with the nameplates on, has actually made it all the way through the first round, as we get the Gen G 2018 special, the Ash Tom Kench, that I'm sure Songyun would love to have on his side, given that Key has played 12 games of the Tom Kench, and Ash is a staple of Songyun.
Very true. Looks like they're going to default to a guy that has risen in the ranks in the support role. Braum, very high tier nowadays, especially alongside Lucian. That can proc that passive a little bit easier. And pretty nice lane down into the bottom side. Can have some pressure. We'll see if Songyun will be playing that Lucian as well. Always got to keep that in the back of your mind.
I'm going to be honest, Valdez. I look at this draft, given the names involved, given their games, and I feel like if we had the blind draft and then you had to raffle off who got which draft, I think Hanwha Life wishes they got Damwon's draft. That's what my read is here. Because yeah. Sowon's Jace has been his best carry pick in his career. And Songyun's Ash Dom Kench, I think, is pretty safe here. You're kind of relegated into Braum as your support because you didn't have access to the Tom Kench. So given all of that, I think Hanwha Life feel a bit hard done by. But of course, the draw stars validity and can be piloted well. Always ironic to see Lava banning LeBlanc, given that he is a great LeBlanc player himself, but see what they want to last pick here for Hanwha Life. Bono has last picked jungle a lot, but now that the top two are gone from, we haven't seen him recreate the same power, so I'd actually like to see him just take a Rek'Sai or take whatever the best available is and kind of grin and bear it and a counter pick for Lava, given that we're trying to understand, wrap our heads around why Lava's back in the lineup to begin with.
Seems like Dom 1 reading into that Aurelia top pretty well as well. Think about the Aurelia. She's only one in the mid lane. 3 games from Tovi, 1 game from Showmaker. Those two players are undefeated on that champ, but nobody else has found another way to get in, as looks like it'll be Zach coming in here for Bono. Interesting pick.
Especially when Jace was given over, and you're like, there's definitely going to be some sides of the map that could be tricky. But I like what they did, because you notice they further extend the Aurelia flex, and they don't necessarily put all their eggs in the Bono basket, which recently hasn't been working. So I like Humble Live doing what feels counterintuitive based on the past. And okay, we get Akali here. We mentioned the potential for Ryze Jace. Akali Jace is also quite spicy when it comes to lane assignments. My first thought, Noggery, top lane Jace, mid lane Akali. We did see Faker on the mid lane Akali this week. From all of that, they need a jungler. They have pretty much whatever they want, and we already saw Xin Zhao versus Zac not work out, so why not match impacts a little bit? Go for the Gragas, who has more teeth in the pre-6 phase, but isn't necessarily bound towards the super early game. Ends up being that Gragas for Punch. So actually, kind of amazingly, no one took Lee Sin.
I know, it's weird. I don't think we're going to have a flex on any of these champions to allow Lee Sin to come in, as Ryze is going to be the final pick onto the side of Hanwha Life. We're expecting that to be into the mid lane that should be up against Akali.
Let's wait for 20 seconds, but yes, this is how you would assume this would stack up based on their players, but things could change. Is something to remember. Timer rolls down.
Swapped once, will they do it again?
They're having their fun. The mind games continue. I think I look at this and I probably prefer Ryze mid lane, but I can understand both of the assignments. Way into the final seconds here. We're zoomed in on Sungyun for some reason. He's not involved here, and it will be Ryze mid lane. Problem for Aurelia is that Akali, especially after the buff, just comes out of the Shroud once and then just waits out the ultimate and takes no further damage. So the Shroud has kind of bonkers value, especially in the mid lane with how short a lane it is. So I like Ryze in the mid lane instead. My query is, though, top lane could be painful without ganks, and asking Zac for ganks before he's good and ready, it doesn't work out. So we'll see how things go there, because Jace Gragas should have a pretty big skirmish and priority advantage early game over the resulting top lane of Hanwha Life.
You certainly have to believe that, and well, so on. A lot of responsibility on his shoulders to come into a game where he's replacing a guy like Tall, and to actually perform in a lane that's super hard up against a lane bully on a lane bully champion. So all eyes on Sohan. Can he actually make it work on the Aurelia that hasn't found too much success so far in LCK?
Really interesting matchup between two pretty even teams. Desperation on both sides for sure. There's no guarantee both these teams make it to playoffs, and your first thought is win today and you're one step closer.
It's a big match. Let's jump into game one now. Pretty huge cheers from both sides as they love pauses. And they're cheering for that, but no, it's a lot on the line for both these teams. So, of course, pouring their hearts into it as it looks like it's a Hanwha Life issue. Maybe Bono's monitor disconnected for some reason. That's not a good thing.
At least now we can see that in fact his monitor is active, so hopefully that's just a once out. G-Sun, you got something for us here? A big Hanwha Life fan wanting them to go to playoffs, and it's also just shouting out the YouTube channel there. Honestly, Hanwha Life have been one of our best squads when it comes to producing content. They put out a lot of great content. Hanwha, one of our last big Korean companies, come into esports, and they're not trying to waste any time. They've definitely made a lot of fun stuff. Well, the bar didn't come out in game number one,
Yeah. Sadly.
That's a great drawing.
It really is.
Really lovingly drawn, the Snow Day Bard. By far the best Bard skin. And we're also getting a headset change. Just a couple of little things before we can get into game number one.
No chair issue, though. That's always important.
Or toilet issue.
Yeah. Haven't had one of those in 2019. games don't go quite as long as they used to nowadays. Back in my day, we'd be sitting here for ages.
How did the global fans get all the lollipops? We didn't find any, Valdez.
I know. Where's our lolly?
What's your favorite lollipop flavor?
Cherry?
Me too. I was going to say cherry. Costa Synergy.
I was just waiting and reading your mind.
Speaking of Synergy, there's too much Teemo here.
Flame, are you going to play Teemo in your next game?
When will your next game be? Also a pressing question for good old Flame. Could be game number two tonight.
Let's get a penalty kill here, Sang-yoon. Let's see. She also ran here after work, or after school, rather.
Well, we are 8 p.m. Korean Standard Time. Oh, he's found three handsome guys in League of Legends.
Flame, Dongjun, and Cloud Templar.
Two casters and one player, apparently.
Yeah.
But there's the countdown. It's reached zero. How about video games?
How about them?
I thought that would be... Oh, we already had the cheers,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, we had the cheers.
I was waiting for some cheers. No cheers. Just some cheers from Gargus. He's always good. Happy to have a drink. He doesn't seem like the kind of guy who needs cheers. He makes his own cheers.
Punt watching that series before, of course, with Cuz playing the Gragas. Can he get some inspiration from there and actually make it work? Of course, Cuz also played the Gragas into Dom1 Gaming when they did take that win, so Punt's trying to take a page out of his book.
Again, we want to talk about the stakes if you're joining us late. Hanwha Life are 8-5 fifth. Dom1 Gaming have 8 wins, but they've played an extra series and lost it. So there's a potential for there to be two series between the two teams if Hanwha Life can win. So Dom1 pretty desperate for that win, understandably. However, Hanwha Life's remaining schedule is the worst. They have to play against SKT, Griffin, and Sandbox. So three of the top three, all three of them, remain there. So fair question. You may have more games to play, but damn, are they some hard ones.
And, you know, Punt and Ugri, they are the duo that always come out together. They're going to start off with saying, well, you wanted to help your Irelia in the top side. No, thank you. We're going to make you go to your blue side and maybe even attempt a three buff here, as they want to take as much pressure off of Nuguri so that he can continue to do his thing and put on pressure in the top lane.
Hasn't this been a while? It's been a hot second since they've vertical jungled around Nuguri on a good matchup. But that's what we see here. Nuguri's in the lineup. Vertical jungling is happening. Jace gets to the minion seconds. Obviously gets not the same level one zoning like we've seen in Jace versus Cho'Gath matchups. Huni will never forget that. So they get the vertical jungling. Zac is probably going to get his camps, though. And that's the cost here. Yes, Zac can't impact the top lane and Irelia gets dunked on, but if they don't pull off a turret dive, Zac's getting half the map. Sometimes we see Zac getting a third of the map or a quarter of the map or almost one or two camps. So there is a cost to this. It does mean that Zac will hit level 6 more often than not at the same timing as the Gragas.
Yeah, and honestly, So-On here at level 1 is doing a pretty good job of denying a bunch of the damage. Dodged the accelerated shock blast already. And got a couple of minions pretty fortunately there with his stun.
Yeah, you have to start E in this matchup, unless you have full access to the wave and guarantee a level 2, because if you're marooned away from the minions without E, you ain't getting any of them. Hanwha Life, remember, it's a split map. They could try a map player. Lava's walking down so early. Tom Kench has the Devour.
Not sure how I feel about this one, as the TP is coming in, immediate Devour. As Aftershock will be good to help Bano get out of there. They do get the TP as well.
TP from the mid laner, so it is a resource that's been gained. But like you're saying, it was Tahm Kench, and there was a heal between the two champions. That, of course, is the choice. Guardian heal. If there was no heal, no Guardian, I could understand it. Now, top lane, there's only three minions here, and the turret shot's already tanked.
It's all about the dives today. Double stun, though, as So-On is doing a dance, but the first blood will still go the way of Dom1. Lava gonna use his TP this time to pick up one kill. Already has his tier. Is gonna be looking for Punch as well.
Punch should wait, and now the body. Very nicely done by
nice.
Punch. He had the extra advantage there. Lava just hoped he was gonna juke more towards his team. Instead, juking towards the blast plant was the way to go. There was only a 1-for-1. So much ado about nothing overall, but look at the first buy. The fact that the kill went to Jace is very significant because he's got the first of the Dirks. We're going to call this one Nowitzki.
Okay.
We'll just leave that one out there. And we watched the turret dive here. The double stun threatened to just completely turn this one around.
Really did, but very well juggled there by Nuguri and Punts. The chemistry, the synergy working out well for them. And a nice dive that does net them that first blood. So we'll see if they can continue with that pressure up there, as someone's going to be under turret for a lot of this game.
We've had a lot of fans on Twitter messaging us about overlooking Nowitzki. We first mentioned Dirk from EU, one of the head producers out there. Then we mentioned the other Dirks we knew, and we just left him, unfortunately, to the side. I'm Australian, so I don't know American basketball as much. So I
neither do I.
I defaulted to English Premier League / Dutch Eredivisie in Dirk Kuyt and Dirk Nannis, the Australian cricket player. Australian or South African, I actually forget. But cricket player is all I said, so I nailed that one to begin. And we forgot Dirk Nowitzki, that, of course, to a lot of our fan base, is going to be the more famous Dirk. How do you like your Dirks? Serrated or not?
No. Just pointy. That's my favorite type of Dirk.
Fair enough. Well, Sohan is, of course, enjoying all the fun of Jace versus Irelia in the early lane. But the vertical jungling to some degree is over. Zac was around, but spotted out by Nuguri.
Oh boy, okay. Gonna spot the two junglers in here. Who's gonna be the first mid laner to get on top of it? Looks like it's Showmaker. As Lava will trade a little bit back, but level 6 for Showmaker means that Hama do not want to take a fight.
What is the result across map? Because we saw a lot of action, right? Mirrored. And we saw a kill trade that we like the Jace picking up. Dirk has got a turret plate already and enhancing the pain onto the Irelia, whose first buy is probably going to be Tiamat, just to wave clear rather than actually the chance to fight back. Across the map, the only other interesting difference is that Showmaker, with two TPs being used, actually in a really nice position against the Ryze. About a minion wave and a half to two minion waves advantage, depending on when the minions crash, is not something to be overlooked too hastily. And this is Akali with a lot of her power returned, may not have the heal anymore. But some of the changes to side laning with the much more reliable ability to arm the full duration W and the movement speed on the passive, there's a lot to like about Akali again. And while it might not be a first pick Akali meta, she's definitely a champion that's around the meta.
You'll definitely see her every once in a while here in LCK, especially with a bunch of the guys that love to pick up this champion. Tovi is obvious, but Faker showed it, as well as Showmaker coming in and making a show for us. Will he put on the carry pants tonight? Something we always hope for in the form of a Katarina, but wouldn't be so mad if it was the Akali this time.
Well, we know who wears the pants in the top lane. It's the guy who has serrated Dirk and Caulfield's Warhammer. No regen, because it's Nuguri. He's got the slam and matchup, and we already mentioned jungling around the Jace vs. Irelia matchup. Punch says, mine.
Oh, he missed
one
it!
HP!
One HP!
That was actually unbelievably unlucky. It was one HP.
How does that even happen? So rigged. Red buff is playing for the red team. And now Bono's looking for a gank. He's got red buff. And a knockoff. Here we go. Okay, ultimate comes in and a stun and there's no hope. And that red buff helps out in making that gank work.
Damwon Gaming left home and the weather report read blue skies. The thunderstorm literally came out of nowhere from the heavens of first a 1 HP red buff steal into a top lane gank to send behind the Jace who had all the items. This is a tilter, and Damwon Gaming have been known for some emotional play from what we can gather, because there's definitely been games that from a very clear kind of flare point, the game has just gone away from them quickly. Watch this play. W auto 1 HP, not 3, not 4, even score was less
he
close
just
runs than this.
Top. The ward just expires, and he's like in perfect range of level 3 elastic slingshot. Okay.
We got him.
Nice.
I like the comms on the other side during the VOD review. The VOD review of that one, of the things that had to happen in a row for that to happen, will definitely be more colorful, let's say.
I mean, say the Gragas gets red buff. Bono doesn't hit level 5. By the way, he got level 5 on the red buff. The Gragas is much higher on health. He he's able to stick around the top side, you know? And most importantly, that E is not in range for the Zac, and the gank will probably not happen. So
that's
actually a big deal.
That's a lot of things in a row. And all Noggery can say is, matchup's still good, turret plates, you know, still on the menu, but he's slowing down. That's what happens, right? He went and bought a Ruby Crystal on his back, so it's not like he's going to be hurting anymore. And flashes it back up. I'm on gaming. Now they're trying to make a map play elsewhere, because surprisingly, top lane wasn't the fertile ground it should have been. Punch. We see Noggery back away because his jungle is bot side. Doesn't always do plays like that. Noggery can sometimes be too lane focused. That should mean that Damwon Gaming pick up a pretty comfortable mountain drift.
No vision down here. Double control ward towards the mid lane. And Bano just drops down a vision ward, trying to scope out what he can see. Seemed like they already knew it was happening, but again, not much they could do to contest that one. So a mountain drink, definitely a good one when you got Ash, Jace, and even Akali.
In the front round, I was loving Damwon Gaming's draft, even as it's all rounded out. I actually really love it, Valdez, because what do you build to side lane here? Because if Damwon Gaming are choosing the lane assignments, you can't build to be tanky against Jace and Akali. It's impossible. They just do too much damage. So it's very tricky to choose your main line. Do you just build health and try to straggle the line and can't really deal with either? Feels like lane assignments here. Remember, Ash, Tahm, Kench, pretty good at also rotating around a good lane assignment. If things get going, Damwon Gaming just open up huge leads if they're on point with their macro. And it's on Bono and so on to interrupt that, because otherwise, we talked about the small areas where the drafts weren't overlapping. It did feel like Damwon Gaming should have the early control and thus have the bigger decision-making to do around the mid-game. But Bono finding more and more ganks, getting Irelia ahead, would throw a huge wrench in the plans.
Looking for Noggery here. Ults are available, and he's going to get knocked up into the stun. Waits on that Irelia ultimate for quite a bit. Nice knockback and a flash. Plus, Yomu's gets him out of dodge here. Well played by Noggery 1v2.
Noggery is really, really strong on mechanical on top laners like the Jace. So the moment that he wasn't able to flash early, he had everything else in point to not die. Very well played there, but the summoner's down, and it is 4 points, soon to be 5 points, at Elastic Slingshot. He's TPing straight back in because he knows that now, with the ults down, they do win 2v2. And it's smart of Hanwha Life not to try to collapse on.
First support up to the Rift Herald is going to be key, but this is a Tahm Kench who could get in position. They're not going to start the Rift Herald, just playing around with it for now.
Bot lane has been CS for CS with Ash. Ash has actually been in that interesting spot, Valdez, where Ash versus Kalista has been going better than we expected for Ash. Ash versus Lucian now going CS for CS.
Yeah.
The old area where that was relevant was in the last Caitlyn meta. I'm thinking 2017 Worlds, 2016 Worlds as well. People realize, wait, just go Ash into it. You have similar attack range, 50 less, but the arrow could punish Caitlyn trying to just push. And so against some of these other lane dominant champions, Ash working out, may not be Songyuns, but Nuclear. Him smashing aiming with a couple of arrows were a big reason that Damwon Gaming picked up a match victory that timeout.
Ibano's pretty low on health, no flash here from Punch. Not gonna force the engage, but Hanwha definitely looking to get on in there. Smite does go the way of Punch though, and TPs are coming in. Sohwan gonna get low and have to flash away. Nice cast to keep him in range and assassinated by the Akali. Gets that kill and is looking for another one, and Hanwha Life are just going to be totally routed, trying to force the fight at the Rift Herald. It's not going to work out this time. Hoyt, what are you doing?
He's dying. Oh, the Guardian!
He lives.
He actually lived with the Guardian Shield. That was so big there. Big mistake by Hanwha Life. They all roll up, but it can only be a 5v4. The only person who can't join is Songyun. He has heal, so he has to play towards his lane. Nuclear teleports in. It's a 5v4, and Hanwha Life are routed.
And the timing of it, too. Three plates in the mid lane. One more up to the Jace in the top lane. So much gold swing goes the way of Damwon after a play like that.
And unfortunately, this was a very controllable scenario for Hanwha Life. They didn't have to full-on commit. The start of it is fine, because you do not want a free Rift Herald going to the enemy. They start to posture, and you're like, wow, yeah, okay, Zac, Irelia, I can see it. Ryzen, Braum, these are strong champions, but the difference in the minimap. Ash can join, Lucian can't. And then very quickly, on what I understand, that they've made a grave mistake. I thought Hoyt was done for. He didn't have his heal available.
Nuclear didn't get in?
Yeah.
Nuclear's like, nope.
There's no heal on Nuclear. Hoyt hasn't got heal available. I got the barrier, and we censored it, Valdez. It was so close that it was actually not stream acceptable.
Now we're getting Coach Box sound as well. A couple of claps and a small nice and a high five.
I'm just happy we censored that Guardian play. It was not stream acceptable.
Yeah.
We're going to cut out of the replay as well. So, guys, good thing you caught it live.
You were there.
Someone is pushing up. Now, the timer here is important. It's the first time Jace has kind of left him alone in lane. It is after 14 minutes. Turret plates, they're not all in Aurelia's lane, but two of them are there. And overall, five turret plates. Four of them, you would assume Showmaker picking up most of the gold around. And 450 gold of bounty comes from the two kills. 50 more from gold is bot lane.
Okay, we're looking for the stun here. Can the Grey Health come in? Yes, it can. It looks like after that tower dive, he's not going to have flash, and it's super easy for Halmon to pick up a follow-up kill.
He was super deadsies, like you say. Endangered species at the moment. We had a scare in mid lane, but that's the confirmation that sadly the benching has happened. As ult flash and Blade of the Ruin King gets him away, but a lot of tools used to escape Bono's turret dive.
Good arrow there. Showmaker able to get that one. The last shot from the cannon picks it up after he does a bunch of damage. Speaking of damage, Jace and Nuguri, two things that go very well together. And how about some kills as trying to get this
wow.
one? The Dunkerino with the smite as well just puts Aurelia out of her misery.
That bounce was literally into Gragas' lap. It couldn't have been any better. The only way I've seen better plays is when Skara says, watch this, puts down a regular Q, then bounces with the ult into his fermented keg. But that one was right up there, so nicely done by Punch. He knows the angles on the Lee Sin. Apparently, Gragas also in his wheelhouse.
Good at geometry and knocking people around. It's two important things if you're a jungler.
I remember how that first turret died.
How about another turret?
Yeah. The second one dies instantly, and the Aurelia matchup that works at, say, 6,000, 7,000 gold, you know, when you're 1,400, 1,700 gold, whatever it is at this point, it gets pretty tricky. We're going to go back to the earlier play where they just decided that Hoyt was done.
It's Tom Kench out of water. No hope for him, no flash.
I need the replay of the top lane angles from the Gragas. Let's see if it's fully intentional. You can usually tell based on the angles. This is just, of course, Nuguri being one of the best at playing pressure lanes. But watch Punch. He rolls in and says, how about everything goes perfectly? What? Look at this! Could it be any better?
Come to Papa. Right in his lap, literally.
Wait, was that me? Was that
a
soundboard
there?
That was
you on the Gragas.
Good thing about being named Papa Smithy. A lot of lines just roll off the tongue and sound funny as hell. Showmaker, in the side lane. Remember, he also, without being on screen doing things, is way ahead. 2-0 and 550 now on that bounty.
I'm alive, still looking for an opportunity here. And it looks like he's going to find an Aurelia again as nice stun, but it's 1v3, my son.
So
see you later.
You remember when we talked about what it looked like if Homolife got blasted going for the Zac drop? This is that game state right now where, at the moment, Jace kills everyone, Akali kills everyone, the Gragas has first movement, as does Tahm Kench Ash, and you have utility advantage. So suddenly, Bono needs to be getting the big kidnaps, and you need to be getting some kills, because right now the map is being exclusively run with more tools by Damwon, and Homolife have to next level them. Otherwise, it could all be for naught. There could be a 10,000 gold lead post-haste.
And Damwon are playing very confidently as well. They're just roaming around the map as a unit. They get Showmaker. Nobody's really able to go up against Showmaker. Ryze wasn't there. They rotate over, get another turret. They already have five turrets here. And the game's only 18 and a half minutes in.
Point to the person who goes against the Jace. Point to the person who goes against the Akali. I'm not hearing an answer on either. Right now, they have the opposite of flexible lane assignments. Lava might not die in both those matchups, but certainly can't just take long extended trades there.
Yeah.
The Banshee Veil's being built. What does that say? Ooh, one Akali, please. I'll try to contend with her. Doesn't mean you'll be able to answer completely, but that's the attempt. You don't always get that lane assignment with all the teleports. Three on Damwon and Abyssal Voyage. And Punch is a pretty fast fat man. He's super jolly going around with his Predator.
He's building up that AP2, not quite the death cap just yet, but he's looking down at his Zonyas real soon here. No Sork boots, but or I guess they're Sork shoes, as I found out recently.
You can call them Sork boots. It's fine.
Okay. I got the permission from Popeye.
You can say
better
tower instead of turret as well. Bush instead of brush.
How about creep instead of minion?
I mean, we call it CS, right? That's creep score. And we call them minions.
That's only because we can't call it MS, because that's movement speed.
Yeah, and it's, you know, a holdover from the Dota days, so you understand why that happens. But we're pretty flexible here. I know that in some other MOBAs, they can be very particular about this. I was told by Heroes of the Storm casters, well, hold Heroes of the Storm analysis.
We're going fishing again as, oh boy, that's a big catch. Gets the Tom Kench and the Ash, but is it enough damage? Here's Irelia. Gets one, gets two. And Nuggery's going to flash over the wall here trying to get away. He's pretty flexible, actually. Nice gymnastics here from Nuggery. Might actually make his way out of this one.
But what do we say? Bono find and engage against five and make it about you. And that's what they did. They pick up the kills. Recreate it might be hard, but here's some welcome gold for the side of Humble.
Zach comes in too and puts down the dunk and makes that three into the pockets of Humble.
This is what Zach can do. No other champion has the threat range that he does with Elastic Slingshot. This game state is what they want. Side lanes. Jay's starting to walk up, but it's all done by Bono, and he gets the 2-for-1 that Zach versus Tom Kench can often provide.
Those Zach mechanics, you don't always have to talk about them, but he catches the catfish, flashes onto Ash, knocks the heads together, and kidnaps them both.
That is some genuine glee on that Hamwalai fan who had the Song Yoon sign. She is hyped, and she should be. She, for no doubt, saw what we did. The game slipping away from Hanwha Life, but they pick up and against the run of play, Zach engage. And until you can basically ward every possible 1,000 plus engage range Zach play, or unless you can kill the Zach, you can recreate that one. We feel like it's easier for Dumb One. They should still have the tools to take out this game. They still have a sizable goal lead, and yet a couple more from Bono, and maybe Hanwha Life can get over the edge after all.
Zach is certainly getting online right now with that ability, as are we just going to start a Baron? They're definitely thinking about baiting it, at least, as it will not be started.
Remember, what's Hanwha Life's predicament? Ooh, the side lane assignments, we can't deal with that. Ooh, they can out-rotate us, can't deal with that. If we bring them all to us, those things mean less. If we can make it about does Zach get the big head bump into the kidnap, way to do that is to make it honest and keep it all. They will win in the five-man while the enemy wants to win in the 1-3-1. So because of that, walking around Baron and milling around Baron, we criticize some teams for doing that. We will not criticize Hanwha Life.
Yeah, I like the play from them so far, even from behind. Even Sowon, who is surely down on his luck in this lane, has been able to keep it at four deaths. Keep in mind, Jace has three, too, so not doing so bad after that start. Was able to pick up one of the kills from that last play as well, get some items, and is now an actual threat in this game.
Let's see how Dumb One plays around what they have, though. They are no doubt a team experience with 1-3-1. Nuggery excels in a side lane, so you know what the enemy wants to do, and the fact that in every other case, you should run the play. How do you close out the game? Intriguing to see how Dumb One do it. Nuggery's rolling down. He is roaming more than you might expect, but Irelia has no teleport. So right now, they roll up with TP advantage and should easily be able to start the Baron control. But do they start the Baron? That's a more bold move.
See, they get that Baron vision control. There is one nice ward, actually. You can spot it to the left of the Baron by Humble Life that has gone unscanned and unseen. It's not going to have direct vision on the Baron, but could be good for teleports if they eventually do get them.
One small mechanic I want to impress on the fans here is that when Zach is going for red side Baron defense, remember that you can't make the same Baron plays we saw, for example, Kingzone doing in our previous series, and they're pretty common, right? Where you stop the Baron, get to 2,000, and then at the right moment, the person with the interrupt goes over the wall or throws the interrupt spell, and you take the Baron. That doesn't work against Zach, because Zach can go immune with the ultimate and ult into the pit to smite it away. So you do have the ability to get through it. Alistair Headbutt, an Ash ult, something like that. And that's a very important thing to discuss. Maybe you actually try to next level the next level and do something like the Akali ultimate because it goes so fast and it has a 0.5 second interrupt. But that's 0.5 seconds that could be the difference. And they got trolled by a 1 HP smite. So stopping a Zac from getting out of the pit, whether he's out of range and jumping in from a long range, or he's using his ult to immune a spell, it is so much harder to go for a smart Baron play against Zac.
That it is in Hanwha Life as a team. Even though they are down in gold, almost 3,000 here, they are stepping forward as five, trying to clear out as much vision as possible. They're not going to go down without a fight. As you guys can see, they're doing a good job of responding to Nuguri's split push. They've been able to get their two TPs close to off cooldown now, which is also very important up against this much split pushing.
And it's going to be a fun game to VOD review for anyone involved from here on outwards, because it should be so clear on who the aggressor is and who's responding at all moments. Dawn 1 pushes out three lanes at the same time as Grog, as Tahm Kench Ash. Grog Hawk shots and put down Deep Vision, and it's a tussle, a tug of war that can only be interrupted by a hard engage or a minion wave crashing that can be answered, say, at the inhibitor line. So right now, with a TP advantage, Dumb One Gaming haven't found a way to stop Baron, which is a small disadvantage to Dumb One Gaming, but not a game-breaking one. They still roll the side lanes, but they don't roll the team fights, so the timings have to be crisp. So I think you practice in scrims, in theory from the coaching staff, and how to tell and level up their teammates. Macro game hasn't always been a reliable one for Dumb One. So we focus on both points for now. Control wards all over the Baron, and Bono's health bar accounted for, but not actually DPS down.
Top lane pushing into Hanwha. Bottom seems pretty even, maybe pushing towards Dumb One, and they seem to come on in and group wall together as the Infernal's about to spawn. Nobody wants to give up that huge objective with this much damage on the map.
However, remember three Dumb One control wards are on Baron, which means they only have two left over, which might be actually be zero, depending on who put down those control wards. And you can't control both sides, so they might give up something to get Infernal control. And then remember, wait, the enemy team has a 5v5 comp. Why are we 5v5ing around Infernal? So they should be able to problem solve a way to actually cause pressure. But now Aurelia can TP down. So things setup-wise seem to be more for Hanwha Life getting a 5v5 than Dumb One Gaming turning the map against them.
Hanwha Life now setting up for this Infernal. They gotta get Sowon in here somehow. He does have his TP. Showmaker, though, trying to zone away Bono. He's now behind them as, okay, Dawn 1 just step on in. Hanwha gonna take the safe way out and say, we will let you have the Infernal. You beat us this time.
Showmaker got them an Infernal alone. That was actually a super sick play. He used his E, yeah, I believe with the Assassin's Path, could have the name wrong, over the wall, shrouded, that kept Bono out. Seeing a rotational play here, I believe. Actually, no, a flank onto Sowon.
Oh boy, Sowon taking way too much damage. There's the arrow to the face, but had to be devoured.
Showmaker.
Doesn't matter, still going down. Showmaker zoning out so much of this. Zac gonna go down on the top side and make that two kills now to the side of Dumb One.
Really nicely played. Remember, this is with Flame in the lineup, and people say he's the one who levels up the shot calling. Showmaker alone, Eid over the wall, shrouded. Bono couldn't go past him, and he solo zoned and got out, and they get the Tahm Kench play out to get further kills. Dumb One Gaming at threat of taking everything.
You notice what they do too. You mentioned taking everything. They don't even let the mid push come in first. They're like, no, there's no reason. We can go
smite.
Stop that. You don't have smite. We can come to Baron, and not much you can do. They're going to try to 3v5 here, our Hanwha Life. See how this does work out. Taking a little bit of damage, but the smite is there.
There was no smite on Punch either, amusingly.
Yeah. Okay, well, he did the damage anyway. Hoyt is going to be the sacrifice, and now here comes Hanwha Life getting that slow onto the Ash. Ryze does a ton of damage, but now they're turning it around. Sowon gonna get that nice stopwatch down, and now he's looking to go in once again. This is so close, but Punch turns it around, and in goes Showmaker 2, as Dumb One are gonna flex on top of Hanwha Life here. Down will go the last member, and Bono alone. Punch comes in at the last second and makes the fight his.
It was a tale of two stasises, but the last one held the victor. Really cool last fight after the Baron And Dumb One get everything. This is after Showmaker alone got them an Infernal from a smart move. They get the Abyssal Voyage in. This is the Ash Tom Kench duo we talked about. So One dies on the back end, as we know. But the further plays around Baron were pivotal as well. Dumb One had the different utility options, but we weren't sure they could use them. They've squandered them before. They get two kills, including the smite. Gragas doesn't have smite here. This is not information to harm alive. They get the Baron, but watch the couple of plays, and I want to call out two going golden moments. The first one is for a different reason after Tom Kench goes down. So One dives in, following up the flash. And you know Zhonya poses always have to be rated. Look how cool this one is. 10 out of 10
yeah.
With the blades extended. Very nice from So One. But punches is more impactful.
Oh.
We were waiting for a Lee Sin-esque play. They get one. It was the body slam flash into Gohan Golden. And that's the moment where Dumb One Gaming breaks the backs of Hanwha Life. It was alluded to earlier. Now the lead is huge.
He's not necessarily stacking up his Magi's or picking up all the kills. He's 1-0-10, but Punch, with that move, may even earn himself an MVP in this one, helping out in the top lane and doing a good job here.
Almost 100% kill participation, 1-0-10.
It's a big reason why they're winning this game, even past that tilting smite that he lost at the enemy red buff. And, well, now we have Baron here on the side of Dumb One, and looks like Bono's going to still be looking for a angle to get on in here.
Only question you need to ask, where is Bono? They don't know the answer. They know where he likely is. Get your poke down before you walk up, as Dumb One Gaming.
Showmaker comes into mid and spots the blob. That means that Dumb One can just poke, back away, and then regroup and go for the push now. As nobody's fooled by Bono coming in here. Oh, they get the rise in the backside, just gonna open up this inhibitor, make that one, and now count them two, as two of the inhibitors will go down already.
Well, at least Hoyt's happy that his friend Nuclear is joining him way more than he was earlier. Dumb One Gaming, it's easy to play two lanes and then just move over. Yes, they can play 1-3-1, but 1-3-1 means that Zach might find an engage on the three or one of the side laners, so they actually play it smart, like you say, pushing the minion wave in mid with Baron, and then Akali sees Zach. That part is easy to relieve the pressure. Take both those inhibitors. And now, even if you engage, the best you're going to do is keep your third inhibitor from going down. So you're stacking the deck, as has been stacked from the Jace. First pick here from Dumb One Gaming. You cannot leave that open for Noggery. He is one of our god laners in the top lane. Dumb One Gaming push up, and Hanwha Life, it's almost time for the emergency engage, and that one very rarely works.
Baron is out, and it looks like this is the moment. Really nice interrupt there. On to the Elastic Slingshot. Showmaker going into the back line too. Nearly assassinates Sangyun almost immediately. As all the slows come in, the casks gonna knock So One into danger as well. And it looks like Dumb One Gaming should be picking up game number one.
Like you called out, the most impactful thing there was the body slam. Excellently done by Punch. Pretty good pose as well. They're gonna close out the game. Well-deserved victory for Dumb One Gaming. And my only takeaway here is that our one-trick Lee Sin's a three-trick now. The Olaf's pretty good. The Gragas is right up there with the Lee Sin. Really nice from Punch, and Noggery Punch.